This is BBC World News. I'm Tanya Beckett. Our top stories: at least three people dead in Arkansas and Illinois as devastating tornadoes tear through America's Midwest.
Arkansas and the state government stand ready to offer whatever assistance is needed.
Donald Trump's lawyers say he'll surrender to a court in New York on Tuesday after becoming the first former U.S. president to face criminal charges. The Dutch government starts using ships and barges to deal with the rising numbers of new migrants' arrivals. And the BBC launches a new education program for children in Afghanistan who are banned from attending school. Hello, welcome to BBC News. The death toll from the latest series of tornadoes that have ripped through parts of the United States is rising. At least three people have been killed in the states of Arkansas and Illinois. Dozens have been injured and tens of thousands have lost power. The governor of Arkansas, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, has declared a state of emergency. Our reporter Shelley Phelps has more.
Ripping away building tops, downing trees and overturning cars. The catastrophic tornado started moving through the city of Little Rock in Arkansas on Friday afternoon. This man told CBS News what he saw.
And through our window, I saw there's a transformer back here that kind of blew up. I saw that, the lightning strike, it kind of blew up, caught me off guard. Went in the bathroom, closed the door, and then all of a sudden it was just like so much wind everywhere. It felt like kind of like the house was shaking and things were kind of like being thrown against it. And it was just something I never experienced before.
Dozens of people have been taken to hospital. Debris lies scattered across roads and tens of thousands of homes are without power. There were also dramatic scenes in Illinois, where a tornado caused the roof of a packed theater to collapse. Experts say such widespread severe weather is unusual.
This is the first time in, I believe, more than 10 years that we've had two areas of high risk. That's very uncommon because typically the atmosphere likes to focus on one particular area.
It comes just a week after a deadly tornado hit Mississippi, killing 25 people. President Biden has been there meeting the relatives of those who lost their lives.
Today I authorized the federal government to cover 100% of the cost for removing debris and emergency measures that are involved in keeping up here, by keeping shelters up and running and paying for every overtime for everyone, 100% of the cost, not for the state, but for us, for 30 days. And then after that, we're not leaving either.
Similar help will be required with the cleanup efforts elsewhere, and difficult hours lie ahead for the millions of people facing severe weather warnings across the Midwest and the South. Shelley Phelps, BBC News.
At least one person's been killed after a roof collapsed on a theatre in Chicago in the US. It happened during a sold-out death metal concert at the city's Apollo Theatre. Several others are reported to have been injured. Though the cause of the collapse has not been confirmed, like other parts of the US, Chicago has been experiencing bad weather. There were winds of around 90 miles per hour at the time. Upset, angry, but not worried. That's how Donald Trump's lawyer has described the former U.S. president's reaction to his indictment by a New York court. He will appear there on Tuesday, charged with falsifying business records. At least one felony offence is included, and that could result in a jail sentence. It's all linked to hush money paid to former porn star Stormy Daniels. Our North America correspondent Gary O'Donoghue reports now from New York.
This Manhattan courthouse doesn't normally look like this, but then it's not every day a former president gets charged with a crime. In fact, it's never happened before. And this is the man who's brought the charges against Donald Trump, District Attorney Alvin Bragg, a Democrat and a prosecutor in America's highly politicized legal system. But if Mr. Bragg was saying nothing, the former president wasn't so reticent. He's called it political persecution, election interference, and his opponents, thugs and radical left monsters.
No one is above the law, not even a former president of the United States.
The case all centres on the financial accounting for $130,000 paid to this woman to buy her silence before the 2016 general election.
Hi everyone.
Stephanie Clifford, aka Stormy Daniels, an adult film star, says she had sex with Donald Trump in 2006, something he denies.
Today it's Donald Trump, tomorrow it's going to be a Democrat, the day after that it could be your brother, your son, your daughter, and we have to be concerned about the rule of law falling, because what's happened here is this is a case that would not have been brought against another individual in this country if his name wasn't Donald Trump.
In the next few days, Donald Trump will come here to the courthouse. He'll have his fingerprints and his photograph taken. He'll then appear before a judge to enter a plea. Until recently, the most powerful man in the world will be processed like any other defendant.
It's finally good to see some justice happen.
It's a political sham, and it's politically motivated.
But this case in New York is not the only legal problem facing Donald Trump.
Stop the steal!
Two other criminal investigations are looking into his role in the storming of the Capitol on January the 6th, 2 years ago, after he lost the election, and attempts to overturn the results.
No doubt,
those inquiries could prove much more serious for the former president as he readies himself for another run at the White House. Gary O'Donoghue, BBC News, New York.
Well, let's now just take you to Rome and some live pictures which are coming in from the hospital where the Pope Francis is expected to leave today pending the results of his latest medical tests. The 86-year-old pontiff was taken to Rome's Gemelli Hospital on Wednesday after complaining of breathing difficulties. He was diagnosed with bronchitis and has responded apparently well to an infusion of antibiotics, say the medical team. So his release from hospital, discharge from hospital, expected to happen during the course of the day. Let's now get some of the day's other news. Investigations are continuing in Switzerland after two separate trail derailments on Friday that took place within 20 minutes of each other. 15 people were hurt in the incidents, both north of the capital, Bern, around 30 kilometres apart. Rail operators believe stormy weather might have played a role. The immigration detention centre in Mexico, hit by a deadly fire earlier this week, is being shut down. 39 migrants died in the Ciudad Juarez centre on Monday, with leaked footage suggesting the victims were stuck inside locked cells. Five people have been arrested, accused of not helping those who were trapped. More than 100 fires are continuing to burn in parts of northern Spain, although many of them are now under control. The authorities say most of the fires centred in the region of Asturias were started by arsonists. Hundreds of people fled the area and a number of roads were closed. The Russian state-owned energy giant Gazprom has said it will ship 37.4 million cubic metres of gas to Europe via Ukraine today. No reason has been given for the increase. Israeli police have shot dead a Palestinian man who allegedly stole a gun from an officer in occupied East Jerusalem. There were no casualties among Israeli forces. Clashes later broke out between security forces and Palestinians. Earlier on Friday, thousands of Palestinians gathered for Ramadan prayers at Al-Aqsa Mosque. A critical incident has been declared at the UK port in Dover as coach passengers face hours-long delays caused by bad weather and long processing times in France. Hundreds of people hoping to escape for the Easter break were stuck in queues overnight. Port officials say they're deeply frustrated by the situation. Well, we spoke to a couple of holiday makers stuck in the queue.
Well, we're meant to be going to Italy, ultimately, but we are booked into a hotel in France this evening, but don't know if we're going to make it now. There's a long queue here, so we don't know. Normally I go on the tunnel, but that was fully booked. And here it's, well, we just got to wait and see what happens.
Well, it's going to be a long one, I think. Yeah, we're going to be here for a while, but it's okay, it's holiday.
Our correspondent Arun Iyengar has the latest from Dover.
Lots of people getting on coaches, going on ski trips to France. Lots of people sitting in cars, lorries, waiting to get across the English Channel. The reason for the delays is partly due to the weather, so delays because of that, partly because of the huge numbers of people trying to leave the UK and get over to France, but also because of French border controls. There is increased border issues there. The Home Office say That's the main reason. But there are also our own UK border controls as well. So that's those three factors are causing this huge delay. I've been speaking to people who've been on coaches, like university students. One coach that I spoke to, they said that they arrived last night at 8 p.m. After a long drive, delays on the roads from the north of England, got to the cruise terminal just outside here, and were waiting there for hours. And in fact, had only just managed to get into the terminal, where they think they're still going to be waiting for another 10 hours. So there's real frustration by passengers. I also talked to people who, coaches that were full of children with teachers. The teachers did not want to be interviewed, and obviously they can't put their children up for interviews, but they said that they were really frustrated, and that all they'd been given was a bag of crisps and some chocolate and a bit of water to see the children through until they can get over to France.
Marina Irongar there. This is BBC News. Here are the latest headlines. Three people have been killed and more than 20 others injured after a tornado hit the US city of Little Rock. The governor of Arkansas has declared a state of emergency. Donald Trump's legal team say he's angry but not worried after becoming the first former president to face criminal charges. He'll surrender to a court in New York on Tuesday. Countries across Europe are struggling to cope with housing the influx of migrants arriving from the Middle East, North Africa and Asia. The Dutch government has started using ships and barges to deal with the rising number of new arrivals. The British government says it's something it is considering too. Our Europe correspondent Nick Beek and video journalist Bruno Bulpup gained access to a boat housing 900 migrants, mainly from Syria, which is docked just outside Amsterdam.
The Silja Europa, one of the biggest passenger ferries in the world. But it's been docked here in the Netherlands for the past 6 months, part of the Dutch response to a global migrant crisis. After passing tight security on the port, just outside Amsterdam, we're allowed on board, where the first resident we meet is 6-month-old Salher, with his mum from Eritrea. He's one of 75 children here, we're told. Further inside, we start chatting to a group of women from different parts of the world, but who all say they've had to flee violence or persecution, including Zara from Chad.
In other camps, we had to share a room with 4 or 5 people. It's not easy to live like that. Here, we have our own room. Conditions are much better here on the boat.
The Dutch government are paying for them to be here because the reception centres are all full up and there's a big lack of housing in the country. Shazar is from Syria. Both her children have died in the past 6 years.
The Dutch have done very well. They look after us, even though there are many of us. It's safe, clean and comfortable, really well organised.
So here we are, this is the restaurant where the residents, our guests.
As we move round, some people tell us off camera they feel claustrophobic and are looking forward to leaving. The majority of the 900 on board this Estonian ship are from Syria. Some have already been given permission to stay in the Netherlands, but are still waiting for a home.
Some of the people living on the shore had complained that those on the boat would be living in luxury, but some areas are sealed off. The casino, the sauna, the swimming pool, 6 of the 7 restaurants are closed. And make no mistake, this is by no means a cheap option for the Dutch government.
It's an expensive option, but that is true as well. But it works. It works for the people, the residents on the ship. It works for the environment. And it's a shortcut solution for a serious problem.
The Dutch government won't reveal how much, but it's millions of euros every day. The British government says it's spending £6 million a day on hotels. It's hard to compare the costs. The residents are able to leave the boat every day, but doctors and nurses come to them, which seems to have soothed some initial anger in the nearby town over fears that local services would be overwhelmed. The Dutch claim this has been a success, but insist it's not a lasting solution, and everyone on board will be taken elsewhere within 3 months. The British government will now decide whether big ships can help address the crisis of small boats coming to the UK. Nick Beek, BBC News, near Amsterdam.
The new school year started last week in Afghanistan, but for the second year running, a Taliban ban is keeping teenage girls out of school. So what are the options for young Afghans who want to keep up their studies but are unable to return to class? Shazia Hayer reports on one new solution being offered by the BBC World Service.
Across Afghanistan, girls' classrooms sit empty. They have told the BBC how it feels. I find it so painful that they are not allowing us to our schools. This decision is against Islam.
For the past 2 years, every morning I go to the rooftop of our home to watch the primary school girls going to school. I stay there until midday when they finish, and I cry. I miss learning new things.
The BBC made lessons for the children to access remotely during the coronavirus lockdown in the UK. We thought they might be useful in somewhere else. This is where the journalists and producers of BBC's Afghan service are coming together to work on a very different task from what we normally do, working on an educational program for young Afghans.
This is Dars, meaning listen, in Dari and Pashto, the two most widely spoken languages in Afghanistan. The show will help people learn English. Maths and science, as well as have a bit of fun.
Where's Afghanistan?
Okay, so yeah.
For the presenters, who are all journalists from Afghanistan, this is a very personal project.
My father was a teacher and he was killed in a suicide bomb attack 16 years ago. At that time, I felt that I want to be a teacher because my father was a teacher. But I became a journalist. But now, by presenting this program, I think that I have become a teacher and fulfilled my dream and also my father's dream.
In Afghanistan, for those unable to go to school, classes will now come to them at home. Shazia Haya, BBC News.
A court in Romania has agreed to allow the controversial social media influencer Andrew Tate to leave prison and move into house arrest. The British-American former kickboxer has millions of online followers, but is being investigated for a number of crimes, all of which he denies. Tim Ullman reports.
Hello, Andrew.
Freedom at last.
It seemed almost like a hero's welcome as Andrew Tate returned to his home in Romania. But he wanted to stress he was also relieved and grateful.
I want to give respect, firstly, to the judges who heard us today because they were very attentive and they listened to us and they let us free. So I have to give absolute respect to them. I have no resentment in my heart for the country of Romania or for anybody else. I just believe in the truth.
Andrew Tate is a controversial character. He has a huge following online, and he's previously been accused of misogyny.
It's been proven that the smartest people in the world are men.
See, that's but thing, yeah. I think
that's been proven.
And I said that female infidelity is more disgusting than male infidelity. And I think that the world agrees with me.
Then in December last year, Romanian police raided his home. Along with his brother and two local women, he's being investigated on allegations of rape, people trafficking, and forming an organized crime group. He continues to deny any wrongdoing.
I truly believe that justice will be served in the end. There is 0% chance of me being found guilty of something I have not done. I maintain my absolute innocence, and I think most people understand this, and I look forward to being home.
The two brothers have been forbidden from contacting any witnesses and can't leave their house without approval from the authorities. No charges have yet been brought. Andrew Tate says he'll now focus on reading the Quran and doing push-ups. Tim Ullman, BBC News.
Now to an out-of-this-world experiment. Scientists here in the UK are preparing to send human muscle grown in a lab into space to better understand the ageing process. The samples will be blasted off to the International Space Station. Ian Haslam's been to meet the team at the University of Liverpool.
2021, and muscle cells grown in a Liverpool laboratory are sent up to the International Space Station. Now scientists are again reaching for the stars, almost, to learn more about ageing.
What astronauts experience in microgravity, so when they go up into space, it might look like a very accelerated form of ageing. We sent these little muscle constructs that we grow in the lab, and we stimulated them to make them contract, like making them exercise on the space station. And then we looked at how that their response to that exercise changed compared to what we see on Earth. And what we found was a pattern that looked very much like an accelerated aging change that was going on. So what's the dream? The dream would be to reduce muscle loss and keep people stronger as we get older.
They do it using small pieces of human muscle taken from biopsies, and stem cells from those are then grown into mini muscles.
Okay, well, it all starts with these scaffolds. There's 9 wells. We have our cell mixtures, so these contain our muscle cells. And what we do is we pipette portions of this into the 3 wells in the middle, and this is where our muscle constructs grow. This is one we made previously, and you can see the 3 strips of muscle that are inside of the scaffold, and these get put into our containers, and they are what get sent up to space.
So that's muscle that has actually grown from that.
Yes.
To that.
Yes.
It blows my mind a little bit, that.
It is a bit crazy, and I still get baffled by it all.
Sending muscle cells to space isn't as outlandish as it might seem. 7 years ago, we covered the story of a pie being launched into space from Wigan. And this week, a model of Shaun the Sheep returned after taking part in NASA's mission to the moon.
And liftoff of Artemis 1. We rise together.
The muscle construct is going to be put into one of these containers. This is where it's going to go here. There are going to be 24 of these blasted off up into space in 2025.
Do you get particularly nervous when the stuff gets launched into space?
You're always nervous. Obviously, there goes an immense amount of testing into projects like that because you really can't afford them to go wrong. So we spend a lot of time doing things like simulated rocket launches on vibration tables. So astronauts only need to unload them from the launch vehicle and set them to go. The rest of it will happen fully automatically.
The scientists hope their work in the unique environment of the International Space Station could eventually help people live healthier lives. Ian Haslam, BBC Northwest Tonight.
The organisers of the Wimbledon Tennis Championships have lifted a ban on Russian and Belarusian players that had been imposed in response to Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Players from the two nations will have to compete as neutral athletes and comply with certain conditions, including agreeing not to support the Russian and Belarusian states or receive sponsorship from companies operated or controlled by them. Ukraine's foreign minister has described the move as immoral. Russian world number 5, Daniel Medvedev, welcomed the news.
I don't have any Russian sponsors, and I'm going to play there like we played all the last year, every other tournament, to be honest. And I'm going to be happy to be there. I don't know what the crowd reaction is going to be. I cannot control it, but I will be happy to play there in front of all the people, hopefully on big courts, and hopefully have some big, amazing matches.
Daniel Medvedev there. Policing has rarely been more of an issue in Britain, with attention especially focused on London's Metropolitan Police. In the capital, one officer has been using his skills to engage young people through a sport which more than 1 million children play every week in England. PC Kip is harnessing the power of basketball, as sports correspondent Joe Wilson now explains.
Introducing Constable Kypros Kyriakou. And if you've never seen a police officer like this, well, that's the whole idea.
A lot of the time when you're with young people, they see us as just a uniform, a robot, if you will. So basketball, when I was younger, it wasn't as popular as it is now, so it's starting to get a lot more popular. And the kids love it, they really love it.
Most people like usually associate police officers with like crime and everything.
Police aren't always bad, they're good people.
When you see someone like Kip like jump that high, it makes basketball look like more entertaining.
Kip, as everyone calls him, is a South London Schools officer. This is the South Bank University Academy.
We know that policing in London right now is under real scrutiny. We hear a lot about the urgent need to rebuild or build trust. Building trust, essentially, that's what's happening on this court right here.
Thanks.
When I would come into schools, kids would say, "Oh, you're not a police officer." Or they would say to me, "Oh, you don't seem like a police officer." So I used to always say, "Well, how is a police officer meant to be?" And you know, and just having that rapport and building that trust with them, that they were then able to come and talk to me, ask me questions, educating about the law. One, two, three, hard work.
Kip used to train with professionals, could have been one. He was recently a guest at the London Lions of the British Basketball League. Nothing commands respect quite like a slam dunk.
Has he inspired you, all of you, to actually dunk?
Yes.
Yeah. Have you tried it?
Yeah.
Because if Kip can dunk,
we can dunk.
He's one officer in one gym. But if PC Kip makes a difference, well, then he's made his point. Joe Wilson, BBC News, South London.
I want to show you some footage now, some drone footage we've had come into us from northern Iraq. You can see snow has blanketed the city of Duhok in the northern Kurdistan province. It's very rare because this is one of the world's hottest countries. And a reminder of a developing story coming out of the United States. Three people have been killed by a tornado in the state of Arkansas. The state's governor, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, says more than 20 others have been injured. She's declared a state of emergency. These are some of the pictures that are coming into the BBC from CBS News. Nearly 90 million people in 15 US states are under threat from an explosive storm system. You can reach me on Twitter at BBC Tania Beckett. This is BBC News.
Hello, the start.